yes, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the story behind the story. It's, yes, Thursday, the 24th day of January 2013. Oh, we got a show for you today, folks. I got to tell you, first of all, I got to just give you some updates, and then we'll get into the meat of the matter. Let's give you a little bit of milk first, shall we? I went back through my file and book, extensive file that I had concerning my personal interviews. I'm talking radio interviews now, back in the 90s. And, of course, personal correspondence, both in email form and hard copy letters, with a man named Milton William Cooper. Milton William Cooper, I have to tell you, he was a great interview because you never know what he was going to say. I mean, he has some stuff that was, well, at the time I thought, well, I got to take that with a grain of salt. I just didn't want to believe all the things, of course, he was telling me. Some of the things were way out there concerning what he called, quote, a federation of planets in the galaxy that really were monitoring everything going on in America and planet, really. And they, according to the interviews I had with Cooper, he said that these advanced beings were good humans. They were human type beings. This is a different part of the galaxy, and that they had come to Eisenhower with, you know, full, they came to President Eisenhower fully outlining to him their galactic agenda, saying they could bring, they promised, well, they offered to bring to Eisenhower cures for many of the world's disease states and the disease problems. They would really set the course of the planet to one of health and nutrition. And the story Cooper told me, I remember this so well. He said that Eisenhower said, it's not up to me alone. I have to consult with the Pentagon, George Hughes' staff, and others. Even, you know, I'm thinking NATO or the allied nations. I don't know if NATO was in existence at the time. But anyway, the bottom line is Cooper told me that Eisenhower regretfully informed this Galactic Federation representatives that they'd already made a deal with a different group of ETs that would supersede anything they could do with the United Galactic Federation. Now, I tell you, folks, again, I am not one of those guys with the tinfoil hats that go out there and connect to ETs and Star Children and that type of thing. And so when I hear this from Cooper, who first of all, absolutely identified his credentials as top-level Navy intelligence operative. What can you say? You know, well, the guy's telling me this wild story, and who knows if it's right or who knows if it's true. I just let people decide for themselves. As doing the news program then, just one day a week, the story behind the story, I reasoned in, well, it's not for me to color the commentary with my subjectivity. I'll just let the people hear the story and decide for themselves. And I tell you this, I've talked about this on the show a number of times, about interviews with Mr. Cooper. In the summer of 2001, I remember this so very well, he said, red alert, there's going to be an attack on the Twin Towers, and it's going to be very, very devastating. And it will usher in a series of wars. Unjust wars, because this is all a false flag. He told me that on a radio broadcast. And I thought, oh my heavens, I guess we'll see. He never specifically said the date. I know we interviewed him, I believe, in July or August of 2001. He never said the specific September 11th date, but he says if he were to guess, it would be sometime in September. And so he nailed that correctly. Just a short time after that, Mr. William Cooper was shot down dead in his driveway. I guess he was getting too much information out, and he had to be eliminated. I tell you this because, going back in my other files, you know, he pegged September 11th dead on. But he also wrote in his 1991 book entitled Behold a Pale Horse, he wrote these words. Let me share them with you, and I quote, "The government encouraged the manufacture and importation of firearms for the criminals to use. This is intended to foster a feeling of insecurity which would lead the American people to voluntarily disarm themselves by passing laws against firearms." And here's how he says how they do this. And I quote, "Using drugs and hypnosis on mental patients in a process program, if you will, subtitled Orion. Orion. The CIA inculcated the desire in these people to open fire on schoolyards and thus inflame the anti-gun lobby. This plan, this so-called, this code name Orion, is well underway and so far is working perfectly. The middle class is begging the government to do away with the Second Amendment." And he wrote this in 1991. It just seemed like it's gotten back on track now, doesn't it? He pegged it right then, and I submit he's right on point right now. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I got a message. There's a story posted on, looks like it's, I'm not sure what website, but Bibliotech, Pleiades. I don't know if it's the same story, but a holy stranger in the Pentagonal Lodge. I don't know. No, I don't think it's the same story. I've read this one before. But I think this is disinformation, frankly. Photographs taken, Valiant and Thor. No, this is not from the Pleiades. This is different. So, thanks for that, but it's not... not the same story. Okay. Here's the point I wanted to make, and then we'll go on with what I had really planned for today. See, this Orion, this project Orion, is pretty... it is ongoing today. I tell you this because when I went back to my papers, my notebook, my file, my discussions with M. William Cooper, Bill Cooper, I can tell you, he outlined quite a bit of this Orion project. This is CIA black ops involving multiple personalities, involving disinformation experts, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, I say this because folks, just do your own homework. I'm just going to lay this out there. And again, when I talk about these subjects and when I point you to the direction of a name, it's not to attack, but it's just to inform. There's a woman by the name of Barbara Hartwell who does a radio show, and she goes out and spouts all the time about people like me and Ted Gunderson being COINTELPRO agents. She hates Ted Gunderson, but she's deeply tied into a guy named Stu Webb. Stu Webb is a flat-out psycho nutcase. I don't mind if he doesn't like what I say. Fine, just come along and sue me, and we'll go to court. Mr. Webb, you are a thief and a fraud. You stole files from a good, honest and hard patriot named Ted Gunderson. You stole his files. And you escaped prosecution because of your connections that are less than admirable. Okay, the way you did it, shame. I mean, it is what it is. And look at the history. Okay, getting credibility, getting some traction among talk show hosts, and Barbara Hartwell has her show. Folks, do your homework. The broadcast network that Barbara Hartwell spews her mind control venom over is Orion. Orion Broadcasting. CIA, COINTELPRO agents, you better believe they're all around it. But it's not me. It's just not me. Gotta tell you that, folks. Now, I just call it like I see it. I interview people like Bill Cooper. Because I interview somebody like Bill Cooper, does that make me a Navy intelligence COINTELPRO PSYOP agent? No, I have never received a nickel from any government soup agency. Absolutely not. I'm just who I am. What I do for a living is in the field of nutrition and counseling people to get their health back. I'm not a medical doctor. My PhD is in the field of nutrition. It was issued outside of this country. It's not accredited by the Board of Regents in this country. It's outside of their realm. So I submit, folks, it's more prestigious than anything in America, because the Board of Regents and the curriculum they put out is bogus. It's bull. It doesn't hold water. You have to really understand, especially things in the field of nutrition. You can't go to school here in universities. I have a Bachelor of Science degree from Southern Utah University, and that is accredited. But my doctorate, my understanding and research and training in the field of nutrition is out of Germany, tied to the network in Dresden, Germany, that was firebombed during World War II. Much of the information in libraries, the vast research libraries, were firebombed. Surprise, surprise, surprise. Nobody in Dresden was manufacturing gunpowder or bullets, bombs, or Messerschmitt engines. There's no reason to firebomb the living daylights out of Dresden, but they did anyway. You talk about Holocaust. Talk about hundreds of thousands of people. You know, they're mainly concerned. Dresden is a hospital city. Dresden is the nutritional research capital of the free world at the time, and it was bombed back to the Stone Age. So anyway, it is what it is, folks. So I want to talk about nutrition today. I really do. I want to talk to you about some some exciting breakthroughs, and I hope you can take a pen and a piece of paper and make some notes today. I'm going to give you some real incredible new information. It's really not so much new, but it is in America. It's not new outside of America. We are so far behind in the field of nutritional research in this country. I'll tell you something. And I'm going to talk to you about some biblical passages that you may not have understood before. You know, so much of the answers to the ills of today are found in the pages of the Holy Bible. You just have to crack it open and read it, folks. You really do. Let me tell you about John chapter 12, verse 24 in the King James Bible. Let me just give you a background history of John chapter 12, verse 24, and then as we go into the break, I'll let you again do your own research on it. Thinking about it is the first step. You've got to understand through your thought process what's going on. John chapter 12, verse 24 is a simple, simple little verse in the New Testament. 24, the verse is Christ speaking now. He says, verily, verily. And whenever you hear Christ say, verily, verily, it's the equivalent of somebody taking a megaphone and saying, okay, let me have your attention. Listen up, folks. This is very important information. Not just one verily. It's verily, verily. Listen up. Hark. Here is wisdom, Christ said. As I say unto you, except a corn of wheat. Now that's corn in the Greek, the terminology is a kernel, corn or kernel, a little piece of wheat. Unless a little corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. Now, what does that really mean? Verily, verily, I say unto you. What was Christ doing? And what was the context of what he was saying? And who was he saying it to? So, okay, let's break this down. Let's have a little bit of one-verse Bible study here today. We go back a few verses in John chapter 12, we see that, again, this is the very beginning of what is known in Christianity as the Passion Week. Christ earlier in John had raised a man named Lazarus. Lazarus was dead, and as is common in that neck of the woods, that desert country, been dead and not long enough, he was so far gone, he was stinking. His body was starting to decompose. It's kind of nasty, okay? So they wrapped him up and did what they usually do, put him in a burial tomb, and that was the end of it. So Christ was a little bit late on the scene coming up to heal Lazarus. Well, no matter. Even though he's dead and he stinks, that's no problem. I bet you can just see the people scatter when Christ came in and said those words and Lazarus raised up from the dead, pulls away his ointment wraps, his cloth death shrouds, and comes out of that tomb alive and well. Oh, I can just imagine the people scattering. And do you think they would keep that quiet? Of course not. It spread like wildfire throughout the wilds of Judea. And surely God right back to the chief priests real quick. They had their spies. They had people watching to see what this crazy man Jesus was going to do next. I can just imagine Caiaphas and the chief priests there in the synagogue of Satan. Yeah, synagogue of Satan. Did you get that, who's ever listening in? And so what happened? These corrupt Edomite sons of guns. Well, if it wasn't a Christian radio show, I could use a real good expletive there, but it's what they are. These conspiring Edomite red synagogue of Satan lackeys. Yeah, you know, here's a man raised from the dead. You think they would say, "Oh, maybe this is really amazing stuff. Maybe we better let him take the throne, and this is powerful." No, they they conspired to put Christ and Lazarus to death. Wait a minute. Hey, they wanted Lazarus dead or alive. He's already dead once. You think he's going to fear you? Come on, you Caiaphas and you ignoramuses, you Satanists in the judgment seat. Come on. But Christ knew it wasn't yet his time. So he and Lazarus, of necessity, went into hiding. Now, I don't know what that really means, whether he went underground someplace, hid away, or whether he went interdimensional. He's God. He can do whatever he wants. But the bottom line, he was not seen anywhere because he knew that if they grabbed him at that point, it would kill him. And he couldn't. It wasn't the time. It had to be in a specific time frame and a specific date on the time of Passover. So, you see, that's why he went into hiding. Now, this is all leading up here to explaining what chapter 12 is really delving into here. So, you see, he comes basically out of hiding, coming into the, or actually the trail, the path is still there on the Mount of Olives today. He made his entrance, and you could see from the high points of Jerusalem where the chief priests were watching, here is Christ making his entrance, riding a white colt, which is a white donkey, which is symbolic. Politically and symbolically, if you came in riding a white horse, you were coming in to militarily conquer. If you came in riding a white donkey, symbolically means you come as in total peace. So it comes in this entry, and the people, oh my goodness, everything, they laid the palm fronds down, there were well over 1 million people in for the feast in Jerusalem. It was, I talk about an entrance of a rock star equivalent. I mean, this was powerful. And Christ made quite an entrance, and it shook the chief priests, Caiaphas and the leaders. Now, this is the background to this John chapter 12. We go back to John chapter 12, verse 20, 4 verses up, and we read, "And there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast." Now, who were these Greeks? Who were these? Why certain Greeks? You see, you look back into the historians' writings at the time. Maybe it's Josephus and others documented that there were disciples of Hippocrates, the Greek physician. that were there. They were kind of in a like a medical school setting, if you want to call it that. They were teaching the people that what they were interested in, the healing arts, the father of medicine, so to speak, Hippocrates. To this day, medical doctors, male and female, when they finish their medical school training, they take an oath. Politicians take an oath as well to uphold the Constitution, and military men and women take the same oath. But physicians do as well. They take an oath. This is called the Oath of Hippocrates, the Hippocratic Oath, which basically say you just can't do any harm. First, do no harm is the first principle of the Hippocratic Oath. Oh, my goodness. So, when we have certain groups, I submit to you that based on the historical record, these were influential teachers of medicine, and they would have a specific interest in this amazing figure named Jesus of Nazareth. That obviously had heard they had actually heard the stories. Hold on a minute, ladies and gentlemen. I've got an emergency text I'm going to take care of. My wife has had an accident. So hold on a minute, please. I might have to cut this story short, too. In fact, we were in the middle of a terrific ice storm here in Ogden, Utah this morning, and the roads are an absolute mess, an absolute ice rink, and my wife just texted me. She's wrecked the car, slid into a snowbank. Oh, goodly. Oh, well. I'll never fails. Hold on, ladies and gentlemen. I'll be back after these messages. We'll continue on, hopefully, with the story behind the story. Please stay tuned.
Freeze-dried food from the freeze-dry guy. I was laying away our family supplies here.
Dad, you're not planning to have an emergency, are you?
You don't plan to have them. They happen on their own. You plan a response.
Like what? What could go wrong?
Well, imagine you go to the grocery store and it's empty.
Dad, that's paranoid.
That's possible.
It's paranoid.
It's not paranoid to prepare. It's perfectly prudent.
Okay, Pops, I get your point.
Keep it.
But, Dad, what if we never need it? Won't it go bad?
Oh, no, son. You'll have babies of your own, and this stuff will still be as good as it is today. And it's good, too. Believe me, I've had some.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Dad, maybe we could have a practice emergency.
Test the food out, huh?
Yeah.
Well, let's hope we don't have a real emergency, son. But if we do, I intend to survive, and I intend for you to survive, too.
Thanks, Dad.
I better get the rest of this put away.
Call 866-404-3663 or go to freezedryguide.com.
Hello, I have something I'd like to share with you. LisaKCandles.com is an all-natural soybean candle alternative. Before I found Lisa K Candles, I had lingering soot and allergens in my home. Not today. My Lisa K Candles are clearly a difference to see and breathe. And you know, that's a good peace of mind. LisaKCandles.com is an all-natural soybean candle, handmade from their popular line of fragrances. And guys, these candles make a perfect gift. Order an all-natural soy candle from LisaKCandles.com. I'm glad I did, and I know you will be too. Visit LisaKCandles.com. That's Lisa, the letter K, candles.com. Or call 731-441-3293. That's 731-441-3293.
Results from satisfied customers of Heart and Body Extract continue to pour into our website, hbextract.com.
This is Al from New Jersey. One day I saw your ad for Heart and Body Extract, and it mentioned that it would help me with angina, so I decided to order. I figured I had nothing to lose.
Heart and Body Extract supplies your body with everything it needs to balance itself and maintain optimal heart and circulatory health with no negative side effects.
I took the formula 3 times a day as directed, and I kid you not, within 4 days, my angina pain was completely gone.
Order HB Extract by calling 866-295-5305 or online at hbextract.com. That's 866-295-5305 or hbextract.com.
I could not believe it actually stopped the pain. Heart and Body Extract actually works. This is just an amazing product. Even the numbness in my hands is completely gone.
Heart and Body Extract for a long and healthy life.
Now you can feel that squeaky clean sensation like none other with Vitamer toothpaste and mouthwash. Vitamer toothpaste and mouthwash is a unique natural formula not found in any other oral care product. With a gentle combination of zinc, folic acid, myrrh, and clove oil, Vitamer effectively whitens teeth, removes plaque, and freshens breath, and it does it naturally without any harmful chemicals. Visit us online at Vitamer.com. That's VitamyR.com. Or call us today to place your order at 1-888-558-8482. That's 1-888-558-8482. Keep your teeth and gums healthy with Vitamer toothpaste and mouthwash. Vitamer, nature's answer to healthy teeth and gums. And remember, it's all completely natural. Available at participating health food stores nationwide.
The Micro Effect is the purest form of alternative news and information on the airwaves today. Be part of the effort to inform your fellow Americans about the things they need to know. Help us reach those that are looking for answers and truth about the world today. For a limited time, we are offering a dozen business card-sized magnets for every $25 contribution. Take a minute and go to our website and take a look at how neatly designed these magnets are. Pass them out or give them to your friends and neighbors. Let others know that we are speaking out and that they too have a voice of freedom. Once again, that's a dozen Micro Effect magnets that are business card size for your $25 contribution. For those who are able to contribute more than $25, we have other offers, such as 30 magnets for a $50 contribution, or how about 75 business card size Micro Effect magnets for $100. Help this network reach America 24 hours a day with your contributions. This is how we fight back with your freedom of speech. If you can't hear us, you're not listening.
And we're back, ladies and gentlemen.
Welcome back to the story behind the story. Yeah, I got on the phone, and my wife is okay. She's shaken up. She has a four-wheel drive SUV, and still slid down a hill and went into a snowbank. Folks, I've lived in Utah for golly now since 1980. I have never in my life seen an ice storm like this. I spent my Mormon LDS mission in upstate New York. I was there in Albany, that Hudson River Valley of upstate New York, above, right around Albany's Schenectady area, notorious for ice storms because the cold, whatever come down the valley of the Hudson River and the would stay down for the warmer air above would come up above. It would be raining and storming, and it would be freezing on contact. But Utah's different. We have none of this phenomenon. I've never seen anything like it. I mean, it is literally in the teens. Mid, about 13, 14 degrees this afternoon, and it's raining. And talk about freezing on contact. It's absolutely unbelievable. There's been so many accidents today. Yeah, the I-15 freeway was shut down and wrecks all over the place. Absolutely crazy weather for I have never seen ice storm in my memory in the foothills and mountains of Utah. But we're seeing it now. Talk about climate change. Yeah, right. This is just climate weirdness. Okay, but I digress. Everything's fine. I'll be able, I think, to finish out the show just fine. I've got to tell you, my daughter is able to go and help her out and maybe get her home safe. So unless they all fall down and go boom, we're good to continue. Well, all right, let's get back to John chapter 12, verse 24. So here we have these certain Greeks, right, that these are physicians, if you will. These are educators. These are teachers of the healing arts. And keep in mind at this time, you know, in Jerusalem and other towns and cities, I mean, the public facilities, waste disposal facilities, are basically your open streets. I mean, you go out and you have bedpans and potty pan, then you dump them in the street. And there's some leprosy and disease. And you see, just parenthetically, when you walk the streets of Jerusalem and walk the streets of really any goodly sized town, it's not just dust that's on your feet, ladies and gentlemen, if you get my drift, is stuff called fecal matter and other nasties. And you just gotta, you know, it's hard to get away from. This is why you see the custom of washing a person's feet so important, and why it's relegated to the lowest member of the servant chat class. Whether you have a slave, that's the guy to wash that crud, that crapola off of the feet of the master as he comes in. And which again, right before his crucifixion in the upper room of the Last Supper, that's what he performed, Christ himself washed the feet of his most beloved apostles. And there was that is itself is incredibly symbolic, folks. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, he who has power over death and has the ability to literally at his word call in legions of powerful warring angels, said, look, you want to be the master of all, you be the servant of all. And he washed the feet, take off his outer garments, because again, you can't get that muck on those outer garments. You see. And here's the parallel too in that story. Even though we may come to Christ, even though we may know him, even though like the apostles. You know, we walk in a world that's full of crud. We walk in a world that's full of fecal matter that falls on your feet. And every once in a while, we have to just come to Christ again and let him clean us up a little bit. And we live in a fallen world. We live in a world of lies and deception, of hoaxes of all kinds, whether it's Manti Te'o or whether it's evangelical Christians claiming to be of the Lord, but in reality they are tied to the synagogue of Satan by their noses. Folks, I got to tell you this. We all have to sit there and let the Savior, the Master, cleanse our feet every once in a while. So that's the picture of what's going on here. You see, these certain Greeks, these teachers, these doctors or physicians, they want an audience with Christ. And so they contact Philip and Andrew. Andrew, if you really see the commentaries and read what his role was, Andrew was kind of like the administrative assistant. He was the guy that basically organized and did appointments and basically orchestrated public appearances. Okay, he was like the chief of staff, if you will. So Andrew and Philip bring these Greek physicians to Christ. Now what? Again, John is giving this the most bare bones, the Reader's Digest condensed version of condensed versions here. But, who knows how long this conversation lasts, whether it was 15 minutes or 10 seconds, who knows? Who really knows? But the bottom line is, you better listen up when he says everything you, it's okay, wake up, this is important. Here Christ had come in, and everybody was buzzing, the entire city of all these people, these pilgrims coming in for the Passover feast. They were buzzing. This is their conquering king. This is the one who's going to put all kingdoms under his feet. Rome is going to crumble, and we're going to be free and powerful. Greater than the days of Solomon, the nation of Judea will be great among all kingdoms. And that's what they were looking forward to. And I'm sure these Greeks were fully aware politically of the ramifications of Christ's entry. So they wanted to see what this healer was all about. And so here Christ suddenly gives them this verse 24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat, a little kernel of wheat, fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. The commentators on this passage, they say, this is really kind of tough to figure out. It's out of context. What is he really talking about here? Christ, especially with learned, wise men like these Greek physicians, he spoke in parables. Those who have ears to hear can understand it. I'm quite confident that these physicians, these teachers of Greece, went away kind of scratching their heads. What in the world is he talking about with that one? Unless he gave them a whole lot more background history to explain it. But for what we have today in the text of John is just that one sentence. Let me tell you what my insights are into that, because it really is powerful to me, and I'm sure it'll be powerful to you if you want to know the secrets of good health and healthy living. You see, he was giving a parable of his creation of wheat, the staff of life. But as it was traditionally being used, and it's still today traditionally being used. Now, keep in mind, the biblical account sort of Christ, after he gave up the ghost on the cross and was placed in the tomb, it was the morning of the third day. On the third day, he would rise again. So 3 days are important in a parable of, again, those who have ears to hear, understand what he's saying here in 12:24. It bringeth forth much fruit. What? What does this one single kernel of wheat, folks, if it's in the ground and it dies, what does that mean? Well, in that context, in the original Greek translation, it's referring to being planted into the earth, symbolic of a body being placed into the earth, the burial. And here's the neat thing, folks. If the soil is moist, if all conditions are ripe, you know how long it takes for the roots and the stalk of a corn of wheat to germinate and start growing? Yes, exactly. 72 hours, exactly 3 days. So Christ was saying, listen, I'm going to die. I am going to die, and I need to die to bring forth the incredible fruit of life. That's what he was telling his disciples and those who had heard, but they didn't know, because they didn't know the story. See, we can understand that now because we know that on the third day he did rise again. And he was giving these nutritionists, these healers, these men of science, an incredibly powerful information here. I don't know if they got it or not. I doubt they did. And let me tell you, folks, we were in our little Christian fellowship group. We were discussing this very chapter 12. A week ago Sunday. And I thought about that. I said, what could that one verse 24, chapter 12, mean? Well, it just looks like, what is he talking about? A single kernel of wheat germinating is what he's really meaning, becoming to life to bear forth much fruit. Is he talking about it growing into another full stalk of wheat with multiple new kernels of seeds being put on? Would that be what? I submit it's what happens in the third day, 72nd hour. And so I was thinking about that Sunday night, and I was meditating on it. I was thinking, what does he mean? And as I was getting ready to fall asleep, you know, you're right in between that waking stage and your sleep stage. And I don't know what hit me, but boy, something did. It came to me just like a flash of a movie screen. I knew exactly what he was talking about. And I jumped up out of my bed and went online and began an internet search for anything that could tell me about what happens at germination within 72 hours of wheat spreading forth. Is there anything different, anything special about germination? Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm a nutritionist. I have a PhD doctorate in nutrition, and I can tell you about most enzyme structures. I can give you 5 hours of seminar right now today on minerals and what they do in the body and how they form inside the cells, your different enzymes, minerals are coenzyme factors, okay? And everything in the cell that keeps it balanced, and we're in a state of homeostasis, of healthy balance, is depending on enzyme balance and hormonal balances. Those are the things that dictate health at a cellular level. If the cells are healthy, your organs are healthy, your tissues are healthy, and if all that's healthy, your body is healthy. And if your body is healthy, ladies and gentlemen, you know what? You're not going to need to spend a whole ton of money on doctors and prescription drugs and what I call the most ponderous ball and chain of slavery, that is pharmaceutical drugs. See this important thing? Is there a link to that single verse, John 12, verse 24? Oh, there is. My goodness, is there ever. I want to come to my nutrition contact website, which, you know, as a professional, I'm subscribed to a number of journals on vegetables and grains and research and going on in Europe. And this, because I just knew what to search for among the thousands of published papers, my search was rewarded. That night I came up with this study entitled simply this, Germination of Wheat, a Functional Proteomics Analysis of the Embryo. That's Wikipedia in layman's terms, in easy to understand language. And what happens at the point of germination as far as transmutation of elements, of proteins? Is there anything? Yeah. The study was concluded and published in the year 2009, published in Serial Chemistry International. Copyright is 2009. Association of Serial Chemists. Now, why hasn't this been given front page news? Well, I'll leave it up to you to decide that. Let me just share with you the basic abstract. And I quote the abstract reads, germination in the soft wheat cultivar Rosella, which is your basic red wheat, which is mostly used for flour production, etc. The hard wheat kernel was followed for 3 days after imbibition, which means moisture being soaked and being put in a medium to sprout, okay? And so they studied the wheat germ tissue the first day, the second day, and the third day. And the study is here in my hand. It is flat out. My jaw is still bouncing off the floor on this one, folks. Not much happens in the first day. Not a lot happens in the second day. But on the 72nd hour, the third day, kaboom. Amazing things happen. Amazing life begins. Again, here is the symbolism. Read chapter 12, verse 24. That this wheat kernel falling becomes germinated in the third day. Unless it does that, it will not bring forth life. Unless I go into the tomb, unless I die, I can't bring forth the fruit of life. I can't bring you eternal life, bring the world. This is what he was saying in this one little verse. What is there in this study of a wheat kernel? Now, keep in mind, I've talked said this on the show many times before. Let me say it again, that there is a mathematical, numerical watermark in both the Old and New Testament, the original Hebrew text of the Old Testament and the Greek text of the New. Every single verse and everything that's of every book and every part of the New Testament and Old has ratios of the number 7. Mathematician Rashid found this out quite, and it's absolute stunning proof of divinity of the text. Why it was put into the text for a specific reason, it's all there. If it didn't fit the 7 structure, it didn't go in. 7. Now, get this, folks. On the 3rd day, the wheat germ had 63 proteins decreasing in value, I mean, completely going away. 63. That's 7 times 9, in case you forgot your multiplication tables. 35 proteins. That's 7 times 5 is increasing in abundance. And 28 proteins staying intact. I'll tell you what's significant about that as we come back from the break. Oh, yes, folks, this is exciting, powerful stuff. You've got to know this. Your life may depend on it. I guarantee you, folks. Stay tuned. Don't go away.
What's better than Mountain House freeze-dried food? Buckets of Mountain House freeze-dried food. Now the freeze-dried guy introduces convenient, easy-to-store Mountain House survival buckets filled with our top-selling items. Each item is sealed in a Mylar-type pouch, and each pouch is neatly packed in clear buckets so you can easily see the contents inside. These Mountain House survival buckets come with well over a 25-year shelf life and are perfect for emergency preparedness, camping, backpacking, or at-home use. Go to freezedryguy.com, click on freeze-dried foods, and choose our 12-month, 6-month, 3-month, 1-month, or 7-day Mountain House Survival Bucket with 32 generous servings starting at just $69.95. And all orders to the lower 48 ship free. Call 866-404-3663 or go to freezedryguy.com. That's 866-404-3663 or go to freezedryguy.com. 100% veteran-owned. The Freeze Dry Guy.
Hello, I have something I'd like to share with you. LisaKCandles.com is an all-natural soybean candle alternative. Before I found Lisa K Candles, I had lingering soot and allergens in my home. Not today. My Lisa K Candles are clearly a difference to see and breathe. And you know, that's a good peace of mind. LisaKCandles.com is an all-natural soybean candle, handmade from their popular line of fragrances. And guys, these candles make a perfect gift. Order an all-natural soy candle from LisaKCandles.com. I'm glad I did, and I know you will be too. Visit LisaKCandles.com. That's Lisa, the letter K, Candles.com. Or call 731-441-3293. That's 731-441-3293.
The last thing the men behind the curtain want is a conscious, informed public capable of critical thinking, which is why a continually fraudulent zeitgeist is output via religion, the mass media, and the educational system. They seek to keep you in a distracted, naive bubble, and they are doing a damn good job of it.
President Bush signed a formal agreement that will end the United States as we know it. And he took the step without approval from either the U.S. Congress or the people of the United States.
ladies and gentlemen. Yes, I hope you got a hold of that when we went before the break. You gotta grasp that. Let me share with you again. Protein. See, that's the basic structure of life. That's what deoxynucleic acid and ribonucleic acid eventually combine to make amino acids, and the amino acids of life form the signature protein energy. Now, I'm going to talk to you in hopefully layman's terms so you can understand the language here. I'm not going to talk, try not talking in the scientific terms here. But folks, we've got a study here that shows that at the very point of germination at the 72nd hour of the third day, 63 proteins decrease. Some of them flat out disappear. 35, 7 times 5 increase in abundance, and 28, 7 times 4 stay the same. Now, this is a branched out and complete graph showing the different proteins that disappear, and then it shows the ones that increase. Let me share with you the ones I've highlighted in my paper here in bright yellow. Proteins with significant abundance changes, they are just massive. There's thousands percent increases. The proteins that are blossoming and suddenly full of life, there are your enzyme structures, folks. Oh my goodness, your proteases, your amylase inhibitors, more importantly, enzymes in lipid, that's fat metabolism. Suddenly they've got lipid structure, fat, essential fatty acid lipid structures, folks. Proteins, they're related to hydrolysis in the cell. That basically are the proteins that facilitate your water pump, putting hydration into your cells. Cell wall hydrolases is what they call hydrolase. It's an enzyme. It's an essentially important enzyme for hydration at the cellular level. You've got oxidase. These are prime enzymes. I mean, this is what the human body has to have. And this one, top on the list. So I said at the first of the hour, get your pen and pencils out. Get your paper out. Hydrogen positive ATP ACEs. What does that mean? In layman's terms, hydrogen positive, ladies and gentlemen, is electron donating free radical scavenging enzyme called ATP. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate. That enzyme precursor is what the mitochondria of your cells uses to produce energy at the cellular level. And this thing increases 1,000% at the point of germination. Can you say hallelujah? Praise God? Now, let me tell you, folks, this is a big secret. I hope you're grasping the importance of this radio broadcast today. I hope you tell everybody that has ears to hear that's not deaf and dumb and blind what this is talking about today. Let me tell you that the key protein that disappeared, the key structures of proteins in the wheat kernel that flat out disappears, the substance called phytate. Phytic acid, excuse me, particular, it's a protein structure. It's spelled P-H-Y-T-I-C, phytic acid. Phytic acid. Now, phytic acid, if you do your homework, if you want to just, again, don't believe what I'm telling you. It's good to make notes and check it out yourself. Phytic acid, ladies and gentlemen. You'll see a lot of things on the internet about it. The government will tell you that phytic acid is a prime nutrient because it's part of the healthy wheat cell. However, honest nutritionists like the ones I was receiving my PhD from in Germany would tell you a whole different story. They'll tell me as I took my exams and studied, phytic acid is an anti-nutrient. It's nasty. There's a group of proteins in that dead piece of wheat, that wheat kernel. Phytic acid, there's tannins. There's what's called complex proteins that most people can't break down. And there's actually such thing as called enzyme inhibitors. All of these nasties are gone. The 63 of them, 7 times 9, they're gone. After 72 hours of water. Christ says, I told the woman at the well, he says, I will bring you the water of life. When you drink of my water, you'll never thirst again. Water goes into this kernel of wheat that he designed, that he created, because he is the creator of all things. At that 72nd hour, miraculous transmutation happens. It no longer is a dead body, it's an immortal, eternal, living body, able to transcend dimensions. Exactly what he was telling you in chapter 12, verse 24. Holy mackerel, folks. This is absolutely groundbreaking. You're only going to hear it here on this radio show. What does this mean? Tell me what it means. You know, the reason I formed my company, Mother Earth Minerals, and produced a line of sublingually applied minerals from boron to zinc, 21 minerals. Count on 21, 7 times 3. Essential earth minerals. Oh, the reason why I designed my company is because I learned through my resident university work that people that consume cereal grains, and that's everybody in America, really, even the vegans, especially the vegans, you grind up your whole wheat flour, you eat it, you know, guess what? This phytic acid is all through your gastrointestinal tract. What does phytic acid do? Folks, it blocks the absorption of calcium, magnesium, copper, iron, zinc, chromium. It blocks their absorption from your gut. So you can eat all the foods you want, all the rich mineral organic food you want, because of the phytic acid in the vegetables. It's not absorbing in your intestine. Now, it's not just vein that has phytic acid. The soy derivatives, soybeans, all lentils, all of these normally healthy foods, they got high levels of phytic acid. Soy is the worst. Soy is huge amounts of phytic acid. Now, when you have this in your gut, you just, over time, especially when you get past age 49, the change of life starts to happen, your metabolism in your gut gets sluggish, more or so. A lot of people after age 49, they've got to take regular prunes or raisins or high fiber diets. Because you'd be amazed at the people I've consulted with. They think it's normal not to have a bowel movement for 3 to 4 or 5 days. They think that's normal. And most people's lives, that is. Oh, golly, today's been a good day. This week I had a good BM in the morning. I tell you, I can't tell you the hundreds of people I've consulted that have been telling me that. Folks, if you're not having a regular, good, nice, at least one bowel movement in the morning, you are indeed kimchi. You're just not absorbing nutrients at all. Your cells are dying off, folks. And it's the very, very biggest problem in America today. I'm telling you, this is what's plaguing America. Big time. Americans are not thinking clearly. They got people all over the place. Talk show hosts, and other people that I could name, but I'm not going to name. They're just so brain dead because they're not functioning nutrition-wise. They actually believe that sodium fluoride is good for you. They brush their teeth 3 times a day with sodium fluoride as a brain-deadening chemical. These people don't know even how to use the bathroom correctly. Okay? I'm telling you, folks, you can't hope to figure out this conspiracy, to understand the big picture, if your brain is shutting down for lack of nutrition. And I'm telling you, folks, that's what's wrong with our kids. That's why we have an epidemic of autism. This is the factor. Absolutely, this is key. Now, I'm going to tell you a sneak preview of what I'm working on. There's nothing like this in the food industry, but there's, you know, I have a vision of change. You know what? Here, I have a dream speech. I have a dream speech, folks. I want to see my children and my great-grandchildren living healthy, strong, happy lives with IQs of 200, genius IQs, because they got proper nutrition. That's a dream. It's real, folks. You do it by eating the right foods. Now, I'm gonna tell you this. It's a simple thing, folks. Here's what you do. You go down to your local farmer's co-op or whatever, and you just look in your yellow pages. You get certified organic wheat, for starters. Red wheat, preferably, make sure it's not GMO, make sure it's not been genetically altered, make sure it's certified non-GMO. Make sure there's no chemicals in it, right? Here's what you do. You take that grain, get you a good sturdy bowl, preferably plastic or stainless steel, doesn't matter. Put about 4 cups of grain to start out with, or less. We'll just do less, whatever. Here's what you do. You put warm tap water, cover this grain in the bowl till it's about an inch or two above the grain. The grain will be in the bottom. It doesn't float. What you want, if you have grains that come to the surface of this, take it and, you know, those are worthless. They won't sprout. You wash that for about 3 minutes. You'll see that the water from your tap, make sure it's warm, you know, fairly like you would wash dishes in, you know, warm water. Wash this grain. Move it around in this bowl and you'll see the water will give off a kind of a reddish brown color. You want to just, after 2 minutes, just be careful of it, but just pour that water off. Fill it up again with some more fresh water, hot water. Wash it again. You'll see even more, you see about the same amount of discoloration in the water. You're going to rinse that stuff off of there. Do it three times. The third time you wash it off, you'll see less. Now, here's what you need to do, folks. You get some ultra pure water, distilled water now. Gotta have it really, really pure water. Because germination has got to happen with pure water. If you've got toxic chemicals in your tap water, it's going to go into the germinated seed. You don't want that. It's okay to rinse it with the tap water, but you don't want it germinating with contaminated water. You following this? Please make notes. You put distilled water, pure water, in till, again, it covers about an inch or two above the kernels of wheat. And then you take 2 to 3 tablespoons of real lemon juice, or if you have apple cider vinegar, anything, either lemon juice or apple cider vinegar, it's got to be acidic. You add that in and stir it in to the water and mix it in. And just let that sit for 72 hours. Room temperature. Don't put it in the fridge. It's got to be room temperature. When you see those kernels expand, sometimes if it's 72 hours is the best, see these seeds pop with a root and a little bud. You don't want it. Again, this is another part of the study. If it goes too long, if this root expands too far and the green shoot expands too far out, then these enzymes go away. So you got to do it right at 72 hours is the best. I mean, the third morning. You drain off the liquid. You got a swollen kernel with a little root and a top. You got the perfect food of life at this point, folks. I'm telling you, these enzymes that are in this are powerful, powerful, powerful. Here's what I've done. I'm telling you, this is something that I was led by intuition, led by whatever you want to call it, the Holy Spirit. I don't know, but I'm telling you, it's this fantastic new process for me. I'm sharing with you today. You can't heat live food above 155 degrees. If you do, it kills the enzymes. There's commercial food dryers that I have. I have one that's American Harvest that when I harvest my fruit trees, my apples in the fall and my peaches, I use my American Harvester to dry them out. So make sure it's the lowest setting, which is about 150 degrees Fahrenheit, and then I lay these kernels until they dry. Just dry them in the dehydrator. Then I take a simple little meal, like a pasta, machine. I have a pasta roll. And when it's dry, you just roll them out and make these. They look like cornflakes or wheat flakes, Wheaties. They do. But just like, with one big difference. They're alive. Boy, are they alive. So once I dry them out and roll them in, I put them in my food processor, my grinder, and I make this incredible flour. Now, this flour, when you put it in, put water back in it or put it into, and again, I never use homogenized milk. I highly recommend this, folks, almond milk. Do not drink homogenized, pasteurized milk. It's dead milk. It's going to kill you, too. Almond milk, much better choice. You put these, mix these flakes in with almond milk in this. It bubbles. It's got Alka-Seltzer in it. I mean, the enzymes are powerful. You want to talk about a power food, a live food. I went back to all of my textbooks, my library shelves, doing my research on these amino acids that come out in full-scale blossoming, this transmutation, this miracle, these 35, 7 times 5 new protein enzyme structures. But I'm just flat out amazed. Every single one of these has been identified by decades. And enzyme factors, every single one of them is incredibly important in the metabolism of the cell. It's like there's not one missing. It's not essential. It's like doing a gift from the creator. And so simple. It's going to take a little bit of work on your part of listening to this knowledge. I'm not asking you to buy anything. Just take the wheat, sprout it, slowly dehydrate it for it'll keep those enzymes locked in, and they store away. I don't know how long they store away, but I bet if it's chilled and kept cool, the enzymes will last months. I'm giving you lots. Today, folks, I'm telling you, I studied autism in children. What causes bipolar condition in people? What causes psychiatrists to prescribe antidepressants? It's lacking a lack of these enzymes at the cellular level. Absolutely incredible. A single, simple little kernel of wheat, full of toxins, really, when you grind it up without spouting it, full of toxins, full of tannic acids, full of phytic acids, complex proteins. After a while, these proteins build up in the cell, and you get the diagnosis having celiac disease. You can't process any grains. You've got to stay away from grains at all costs. Guess what? When these things, this miracle grain has sprouted, these toxins disappear. They're gone. Bye-bye. The body, the carnal body, is gone. You see, again, there's that parallel that's incredible, terrible. You give up your carnal body when you come to the Lord. You give up your fallen devilish self, and you're reborn again. You're renewed again. Now, I was sharing this breakthrough with a friend who's a researcher in Wyoming, neighborhood of Utah. He's happened to be coming through. I like meeting with him because, you know, we have one common thing. We know we're both experts, if you want to call it that, on forbidden archaeology discoveries across America that have been hidden and squirreled away. This gentleman has a brother who's one of the real intimate characters in the Dead Sea Scroll material, the translated Dead Sea Scroll material that talks about the community, the Essene community burned. As I was sharing this with him, you know what he told me? He said the Essenes, this one gospel there, the Essenes, they talk about being taught by Christ. And you know what that community did? According to the scroll material, they ate nothing but a little bit of fish once in a while. They had fish, but their staple staff of life was sprouted grain. I couldn't believe it when I was hearing what he was telling me. He would sprout the grain in 72nd hour. They would roll out with their flat rocks. They would heat it on hot stones in the fire, and they made what they called the steamed bread, which was their staff of life. Just rolled out this special living enzyme flour, mix it back up with water or a little bit of goat's milk, unpasteurized, unadulterated, pure goat's milk. And that was their staff of life. They sweetened it with honey. And man, they lived extremely healthy, productive, powerful spiritual lives. Oh, yes, folks. Oh, yes. What you don't know is killing you. What you don't know, our ignorance of nutrition is killing us. Take a break, folks. You think about what I'm talking about here. I'm going to come back.
Even raccoons respect the authority of a man with good nutrition. That's me. Now, what's going on here?
Well, he started it, sir. I was trying to clean his fish, and he tried to take it from me.
Yeah, well, you must have looked a little wimpy.
Sir, I'm hungry.
Johnson, if you'd have brought your own supply of freeze-dried food from the freeze-dry guy, like I told you, you wouldn't have to be out here picking on the cute little animals.
Oh, I'd give anything for a big chunk of protein right now.
Johnson, don't salivate. It's unbecoming a Marine.
I'm sorry, sir. I should have called the freeze-dry guy.
Bugs you, don't it, Johnson. You're suffering your MREs, and I'm enjoying chicken a la king, lasagna, and bacon and eggs for breakfast.
Sir, shut up.
Johnson?
Sorry, sir.
Get your own supply of the best long-term storage food available. Call 866-404-3663 or go to freezedryguy.com.
My folks. Ronnie McMullen here for Life Change Tea. I want to share a truth with you. Many people call Life Change Tea to get help with health issues that are severe and life-threatening. They've seen their doctor, and they're now motivated to be proactive in their health. Please listen. Once you are sick, it is a hard climb. Life Change Tea can help you, but it's a hard climb. Folks, there's an easier way. Tune your body up before you get sick. A drink a day will help keep the doctor away. Cleansing your colon is so crucial to good health. Seek the easy path and order today. Order now. It's easy. Log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. The emergency room is not a place for a friendly get-together. Again, 928-308-0408. Or you can order online at GetTheTea.com. Once again, GetTheTea.com.
Regardless of the dollar price involved, 1 ounce of gold would purchase a good quality man's suit at the conclusion of the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, the presidency of Franklin Roosevelt, and today. You may not be in the market for a new suit, but you don't know what the future may bring. And gold is the one financial constant the world has ever known. It can always provide you with your basic needs. Whether you're looking for junk silver, old silver dollar rolls, gold bullion, or fractional tradable gold pieces, Kettle Moraine is your full-service representative with over 50 years of knowledge and personal experience. Visit FlyingEagleGold.com or call us at 623-327-1778 today for competitive prices on all your gold or silver needs. If you're looking for real financial insurance, call Kettle Moraine today at 623-327-1778. That's Kettle Moraine, 623-327-1778.
Yeah, we're back, folks. Oh, my heavens. I have also here my desk a file with, oh, no, less than 20 letters sent to me, actually sent to my attorney, for comments I've made as a talk radio show host in my 20-plus years of doing the show. Threatening letters claiming, you know, that they're going to take me to court and sue me because I'm slandering their product and their company's good name. And I tell you, I say, well, I don't have any money to come after. I mean, come and take my skateboard if you want, take my civvies. I don't really have much to take and whatever. I mean, you see, there's laws in place now. They've raised the ante. It's not a civil suit. They're threatening the Gestapo, Food and Drug Administration, and the Big Food. I call them, there's Big Pharma, and then there's Big Food. You know, and here in Utah, especially, we have a lot of cereal manufacturing plants. Big time, and they provide a lot of employment to people. I gotta tell you, I've said this before on radio shows, and it's been threatened with criminal arrest and prosecution. Criminal! You see, it's a criminal act to give disparaging comments against a product on store shelves these days. What I'm going to say now will probably get me in trouble. I have to preface what I'm saying with, this is my opinion. I'm Gomer Pyle, and I'm not just going to tell you. It's just my opinion now. See, this is where my attorney says, you have free speech to give your opinion, but if you come out and say, as a PhD research doctor, this is dangerous, okay? I gotta play their game. I don't want to go to jail. I don't want to be force-fed their jail food. So it is my humble opinion that industrial processed cereals are killers. Call them cereal killers. Ha! I talked about this 5 years ago. I said, talk about cereal killers, people that kill hundreds of people covertly. Well, cereal killer. That's just my opinion. Yeah. But folks, do your own homework. Here's what happens. I've toured Utah cereal plants. I don't want to really name names, but I don't care. Maltonville is one. Post and Kellogg, General Mills, all the time. The Maltonville factory that I toured, yeah, it's spotless. I mean, the sanitation is immaculate. Sparkling, beautiful, clean. Smells great. Really does smell good in there. These big, huge machines, you see, they're called extrusion machines. It's called industrial extrusion machine. They take a grain, which is, again, loaded with all these anti-nutrients. They don't, I tried to talk to them about these anti-nutrients. Well, who are you? We're the FDA and the Department of Agriculture says they're okay, so they're okay. Who are you? See? But here's what happens. They take and grind these up and they mix them up with, again, commercialized, best described, chemical concoctions. They make these, it's a slurry. It looks like a brown gravy. And they do it at a very, very high temperature. It's like homogenization. You know, it really is. The Department of Agriculture comes in to make sure. It has to be 450 degrees Fahrenheit speed boiling. It's a slurry. It's boiling it. Now, folks, what I learned in my PhD work, and again, not accredited, it's out of the United States. When you heat grain, a grain slurry, or oat slurry, or rice slurry, or soy, whatever, and you heat it to a high level, what happens is it changes the anti-proteins and concentrates and makes them more dangerous. Absolutely. The more you have of that brand, the more you have of that external exoskeleton, the more concentrated those anti-nutrients are. You listening to me, folks? Now, they put this slurry of grain, this concoction, which is nasty stuff, really. And these little holes at very high pressure. Then the blades come off. So they chop them off. They can make little puffs or flakes or what's really cool is to watch them make the O's, those little, O's like Cheerios. They slice them off in the machine with the conveyor belts, put them on them. They just go. And each little flake or puff is conveyed by the spray nozzle, and it's sprayed with this concoction. It's a mixture of corn oil primarily, or canola oil and sugar combination. What that does, and then it goes in and it's heated, and boom, it becomes hard and crispy. It makes you go crack to and put in homogenized and pasteurized dead milk. Now, folks, here's what happened. And I swear, I know I have to cross the line because this is not opinion anymore. It's just fact. When you go through this extrusion process of a high heat like this destroys the essential fatty acids. What little good is in the grain is destroyed. Whack. Destroys the vitamins, destroys the minerals. Amino acid chains are altered and they become toxic at this point. The amino acid called lysine, which is multiplied extremely, 1,000-fold when it's terminated, that amino acid lysine is denatured and toxic. Now let me tell you why. Again, I'm just saying a silent prayer here that I'm not going to get hauled off to the hoosegow for this. I got threatened big time with this. But this was not an internet radio show. This was a public radio show I did. People listening on the high freeway probably wrecked and called their attorneys. Folks, I can give you copies if you want this. There is a University of Michigan. Go Michigan Wolverines, Michigan University at Ann Arbor, Michigan. It was in 1963. What a year. Dave Kennedy was signed. 18 laboratory rats at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, 18 special lab rats were divided into three groups. One group were fed, and I kid you not, Purina rat chow water. Do you know there was such a thing as rat chow? Well, you know, lab rats are given special rat chow, you know, rat diet, rat food. This was the control group. The second group was given cornflakes. I won't tell you the brand of cornflakes, but you can pretty much get my drift. Popular cornflakes and water. Cornflakes that had been extrusion process. And that, it doesn't matter whether it's corn or wheat, or soy, when it's extruded, these alterations happen. All grains. Corn is a grain. It's the same problem. The third group, they thought, well, what can we do? They chopped up the box, the cardboard box. They chopped it up into fine bits and gave them to these other control group of rats. Well, the rats eating the rat chow, they were used to eating, no problem. They remained in good health throughout the experiment. Folks, the rats eating the cardboard and water became lethargic and sleepy and eventually died of starvation and malnutrition. But guess what, folks? Fact. The rats eating the cornflakes and water died first twice as fast as those eating the cardboard box. They didn't die of starvation, folks. They didn't die of malnutrition. They died of toxicity. They died of poisoning. And here's what happened. The rats developed schizophrenic behavior. They threw fits and tantrums that were in a rat world. You can see they were just going nuts. They actually fought each other, bit each other, scarred each other, raised wounds on each other, and then died in convulsive fits. Dumped in 2 weeks, and took them a month and a half to die of starvation from eating the cardboard box. That's what happens, you see, when you into your body anti-nutrients. Anti-nutrients are just another word for toxins, folks. They build up. Now, let me tell you of a personal case history that I know personally here in Utah. I consulted for this family, and I was so incensed over what was going on that, again, I got a letter, cease and desist letter, again, threatening a lawsuit for disparaging good, wholesome breakfast food. His name was Bruce. Friend of a close family. I know the family, knew Bruce. Bruce was born premature, you see. And I get emotional talking about this, because it's striking. The family's beautiful family. But Bruce, several weeks born too soon, he was put in the incubator and had all kinds of problems digestive-wise. He was colicky, cried all the time. I went and got his full history. You see, because he was, his family says, Dr. Rock, can you help him? Well, yeah, I got to look at, again, for nutrition and see what we can find out. Let's see his history. He was so colicky and couldn't hold any milk down. They had to make a special formula for him, a special soy-based formula. He took his formula until he was 10 months old. And he started eating some solid food. But it was exclusively the soy and sugar special formula. Loaded, I found out, also corn syrup. Bruce couldn't sleep at night. He had what the school psychiatrist called night terrors, night sweats, imaginary black monsters under the bed in the closets at age 3. By age 4, Bruce was in trouble. Bruce, at age 4 years old, little 4-year-old, had a neighborhood boy playing with him and took a baseball bat to this other boy, knocked him flipping unconscious with the baseball bat. Luckily, he didn't crack his skull. In his preschool, he constantly bit other children until they bled. He would come and bite him, and they would draw blood. This is what we're classified problem child. Are you getting the picture, folks? He was in daycare centers, but they couldn't hold him there. He was expelled from them. At 6, when he went out to kindergarten, nobody wanted him. Caseworkers that I spoke with, he has no boundaries, no rules. When he was being angry as often as possible, he would smash objects and break the furniture. It was just absolutely one time in the school he defiantly messed his pants and rubbed the feces on the wall. Finally, he took a kitchen knife, put his tooth on, threatened to kill himself and his younger brother, and that's when he was placed in foster care. Yeah, can you help the kid? We can't handle him. The parents actually, you see, were divorced about it. They couldn't handle it. It's a separated, bad situation. But see, Bruce's story is not uncommon, folks. Bruce today still taking high doses of Ritalin, Effaxor and Clonidine. Oh, my goodness. You look at these people that are out shooting up schools and their history. This is the type of drugs that they're on, folks. Now, here's what I began to talk about and to ask questions. And I did it on the radio, folks. I said, look, here's the answers. And here you got to focus on. You can reverse this, but you've got to find the problems first, you see. I didn't want to see what Bruce was eating so much as what his young mother was eating. And she was, when Bruce was growing in her womb. She was a diet Coke-aholic, first of all. Coke, 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 Coke. Second of all, she lived off of breakfast cereals. She ate them two, sometimes three times a day. She had for all of her life. The soy formula that gave Bruce was loaded with high fructose corn syrup. When Bruce was old enough to be weaned off of high fructose corn syrup, you know what he ate? Mama gave him tons, all he could eat. They bought it by the big, big bag full bulk. Count Chocula and Fruit Loops. Count Chocula. Fruit Loops. I wonder why Bruce is a problem child. Wonder why America is in trouble. Here's the statistic, folks. 93% of American households eat these foods three times a week. 9% eat them once or twice a week. You don't think we have a problem in this country? And yeah, you know, talk about food giant. How is this voice of reason going to respond to General Mills, Kellogg's, and Post, and others with billions of dollars of control, with the whole army of attorneys and lobbyists on Washington, D.C.'s Capitol Hill? You know, I'm David, and this Goliath is bigger than Goliath of Gath. But you know what? I have three nice little stones in my pocket. These are called the stones of truth, logic, and wisdom. Facts, ladies and gentlemen. Facts. We wonder why America's mortality now in developed nations is down to 37 out of 60 industrialized nations and dropping. We wonder why we have childhood obesity. We wonder why we have test scores in the schools that are dropping like a proverbial rock. Well, we have, ladies and gentlemen, one out of three children now are marked in blood tests with early signs of diabetes. Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta says that one out of every two, 50% of black and Hispanic children will have diabetes by the time they're 15. One out of two. And for Caucasians, one out of three. 33%. That's just flat out unacceptable, folks. We talk about the dangers of cigarette smoking. We talk about drug abuse. And yet we go into the supermarkets and we see rows of extrusion produced toxic poison cereals on the bottom shelves. Why is that the case? Well, I'll tell you why. Because it's marketing. They want the kids to come along with mommy and daddy to be down there and seeing what, oh, mommy, can we have this one? How about this one? How about this one? Go and see. And folks, if you think that shredded wheat, they're all extruded. Whole grain, health food stores, cereals are all extruded. And if you have more whole grains in the extrusion process, it's even worse. The toxins is even more concentrated. You want to know why it is that when you're age 50 and above, they want you to go for a exam of your gastrointestinal